Welcome back learners to my channel. Myself Sumit Rathod, working as assistant professor at Sri Vilayapalle Kelvani Mandas Institute of Pharmacy, Dhule, Maharashtra, affiliated to Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Technological University, Dibatu, Lonari, Maharashtra. Dear friends, today we are going to discuss from chapter number 1 from unit number 2. That is nothing but a drug distribution system in a hospital. So dear friend, before moving forward, we need to discuss the learning objectives for current topic. When we discussed about the learning objectives, which will be being divided into three important components. In a first component, we are going to discuss the dispensing of a drug to inpatient pharmacy, types of a drug distribution system to the inpatient pharmacy. Then in second component, we are going to discuss the charging policies and the labeling policies, dispensing of a drug to the ambulatory patient or dispensing of a drug to the OP pharmacy. In third segment, we are going to discuss the dispensing of a controlled drugs. So these are the three important topics we need to discuss under this headline. So before moving forward for our actual discussion, we need to discuss about the introductory part related with the drug distribution system. So drug distribution system, what is the drug distribution system? Drug distribution system is known as physical transfer of a drug from pharmacies to different locations inside the hospital where medication being utilized for the said purposes. The overall drug distribution system involves indefinite type of a department, procedure, channels, persons, equipment and the storage facility. Hence, the rationale of the present topic is to involve the study of a drug distribution system with respect to different required parameters, which mainly includes the type of a department to which the drug is distributed across the hospital, the medication management procedure which is being required for this drug distribution system, storage and stock arrangement of the medication across the hospital, procedure for the dispensing of a medicine based upon the department involved, either OP department or either IP department, utilization of a personnel and a location for the drug distribution panel or a system. So now we need to discuss the first parameter, that is the type of department to which a drug is distributed across the hospital. So the first department, that is nothing but the OP pharmacy or OP services, outpatient services, and the second department is nothing but the IP services or IP pharmacy. That is nothing but the inpatient pharmacy. So these are the two important departments with where we need to distribute a drug across the hospital. Dear friend, the second important parameter is nothing but the medication management procedure. The drug distribution or a dispensing system inside the hospital will be understood with the help of a medication management protocol. So there are the five important components of a medication management protocol. The first component is nothing but a prescription. Second one is called as a transcription. Third one is called as a dispensing. Fourth one is nothing but the administration. Fifth one is nothing but the monitoring. So these are the five important components of medication management inside the hospital. And overall healthcare system will be utilized to operate these five important components. So in coming presentation, we came to know what are these medication management procedure and how different healthcare system is involved in that particular procedure. In the first step, the doctors writes a drug order in a drug chart. Always they need to write a drug order in a drug chart. Either it is a new point, new order, or either there is a change in order. After the drug written by the doctor in a drug chart, this drug chart will be handed over to the nursing staff. Nursing staff, they call to the pharmacist for the first appropriateness review. If nurses take these medicines or utilize these medicines from their drug basket method or from their impress stock, she or he should be called a pharmacist for the appropriateness review before using this medication from their impress stock. So appropriateness review is nothing but it is a screening procedure which has been performed by the mainly a clinical pharmacist, which is responsible for reviewing the medication order written by the doctors during the prescription component and the transcription by the nurses during the transcription process. So the appropriateness review done by the pharmacist after transcription and before dispensing. After giving approval for each drug order during the appropriateness review, the order or the request will be sent to the concerning pharmacy department, where they will receive this order in the form of Indiad and they will dispense the medicines. After dispensing the medicine, they will pack these medicines and send back to the nursing station where they have to administer this medication to their patient. So before administration to this medication, the second appropriateness review has been carried forward by the nursing staff to check whether the medicines which has been dispensed as per the order or not. So the second drug review which has been carried out inside the ward or ICU which has been performed by the nursing staff. After proper confirmation, nursing staff administered the medicines to their patient. So this is the fourth component, drug administration. After administrating, they have to stay back with the patient for certain time of period to monitor the patient for any kind of a vitals which has been observed after the every drug which has been administered to their patient. So this whole all process is called as a medication management procedure which has been performed inside the hospital and which is related with the medication uses. Now we need to discuss the drug distribution system to the outpatient department or ambulatory patient. Outpatient or ambulatory patient refers to the patient not occupying any bed inside the hospital, clinics or healthcare centers. The patient with the minor and common illness need to visit the physician in OPD region. After visiting the OPD region, doctor write a drug order in a manual format, in a manual prescription. So no medication should be issued without any kind of a prescription which has been given to the patient. After issuing the prescription, they have made the quantity supplies must be recorded into the pharmacy record. In short form, the outpatient department are called as a OPD department. So after the getting the manual prescription, pharmacy the patient will needs to reach to the pharmacy for getting their medicine. So we need to discuss what kind of a drug distribution system will be performed once a patient reach to the pharmacy. So we need to discuss the drug distribution system in OP services. As we know, when a patient will reach to the physician in the OPD basis, so consultant doctors write a prescription discharge summary to the OPD area, emergency or a dialysis unit. So after writing a drug order in a manual format, patient with the original prescription or discharge summary need to reach to the OP pharmacy. The pharmacists who are present at the prescription counter of OP pharmacy, they will receive the prescription in a dignified manner from the patient and they will start understanding the prescription. So pharmacists understand the prescription, discharge summary and tell the patient regarding the frequency, doses and the payment mode. Afterward, data entry operator bills the prescription, medication and given the token number to the patient. Meanwhile, patient will ask to wait for some time. So this prescription along with the bill will hand over to the another person who are being present in a restricted part of a OP pharmacy, that is nothing but a dispensing pharmacist. So once this prescription along with the bills will hand over to the dispensing pharmacist dispense the medication and hand over this medication for the next step of a dispensing protocol, that is nothing but a rechecking and prescription audit counter. So during the rechecking, the prescription, discharge summary, bills and the medication are checked by the rechecking pharmacist for the right medicines, right quantity, right batch number, expiry and the MRP. While a prescription audit counter, a clinical pharmacist will present over there. They will cross check for the right drug, right dose, right patient, right frequency, right quantity and right dosage form. After double checking, if there is a no error occurs in a prescription order, the medicines and the prescription or the discharge summary and the bill is handed over to the cashier for the payment by displaying a token number and call the patient who is waiting in a patient waiting area. If any error occurs during this procedure, so there is a role of a clinical pharmacist. the clinical pharmacists, what they do, they will do the photostat of the prescription and detail summary. After doing the photostat, they will convey to the concerned clinician for the correction or physician for the correction. After made the correction, they will do the documentation, and finally the drug or the medication will be handed over to the patient. So this is the overall process of a drug distribution system in a OP services. So similarly, like OPD pharmacy, we need to discuss the drug distribution system to the IPD or inpatient pharmacy department. The drug distribution system of IPD is a quite different from the OPD because it involves certain kinds of a procedure based upon the charging and the non-charging categories of a medicine. What is this? We need to discuss here. The drug distribution system to inpatient department can be carried out or can will be a different from the outpatient dispensing area. The staff involved in the dispensing of a drug for the outpatient can be dispense the medicines to the inpatient also, based upon the necessity, based upon the requirement. If a workload seems to be heavy, then additional personnel can be employed for the drug distribution system either to OPD or either to IPD. The pharmacist employed for the drug distribution system to inpatient ward should be a well-skilled and qualified staff. This is very important, and generally endorsed pharmacist will be considered for this work. Now we need to discuss the type of a drug distribution system to IPD level. There are the five different types of systems are utilized for the drug distribution system to inpatient department. Which are those we need to discuss? The first one is nothing but the individual prescription order system. Second one, a complete floor stock system. Third one is a combination of individual prescription and a floor stock system. Fourth one, unit dose system. And the fifth one is a non-floor stock system. So these are the five important types of a drug distribution system for IPD level. So friend, we need to discuss the first part, first segment from the drug distribution system to IPD level. That is nothing but the what is the individual prescription order system. This individual prescription order system is also called as the Indian generation system. So basically it is in a type of a drug distribution system wherein physician write a prescription for the individual patient who obtained the drug, prescribed from the hospital dispensary or pharmacy, or charging of an item utilized will be added to the patient final bill at the time of a discharge only. Individual prescription order system will be illustrated and given in the following presentation. So, doctor document the drug order in a drug chart, as we already discussed. Then nurses goes to the hospital information system and fills the login details of the patient during the transcription process. So this, the first process is nothing but a prescription process. After completion of a prescription process means writing a drug order in a drug chart, this drug chart will be handed over to the nursing staff. Nursing staff will return back to their station and they will go for the hospital information system or login into the hospital's software system. Then they will fill all necessary information related with the patient over there. They will select the IP number, inpatient pharmacy number, patient name, nurse's activity. After selecting the activity, they will enter the drug name, dosage quantity, frequency, route of administration, and relation with the any kind of a instruction like a relation with the meal or something like that. So such process of putting the information from drug chart into the system is known as the transcription process. After doing this activity, they click on the save and OK. Then finally, a prescription is raised successfully. A prescription approval done by the pharmacist, which is present in the ward or ICU. Then after getting approval from the prescription audit team, the medication order, that is called as the intent. Then this medication order will be considered as the intent. This intent will reach to the concerned IP pharmacy or the departments of IP pharmacy. Medication utilized will be charged to the patient on individual basis during the billing on discharge, because the bill, the medicines will be charged based upon the patient details. So the all charging of medicines will be carried out based upon the IP number or the UHID number, unique hospital identification number given to the patient. This is all about the individual prescription order system or Indian generation system for inpatient pharmacy. So this is Now friends, we need to also discuss the second method, that is nothing but a complete flow stock system. So drugs are given to the patient from the nursing station. The pharmacy supplies these drugs to the nursing station. The way of a flow stock distribution system mainly include in two types. The first type is called as a charge flow stock system, which is also called as an impress stock. Second type is called as an uncharged flow stock system, which is called as an emergency medicine. Means not all medicines which is being utilized for the patient will be charged from the patient itself. There are some chargeable medicines and there are some non-chargeable medicines. So all emergency medicines which are being used in emergency condition is not chargeable to the patient. So charged flow stock system, which is called as an impress stock. In this methods, medicines are stocked in the nursing station all the time and charged to the patient after admission to them or after administering to them. The impress stock always locked and established in the medicine preparation room of every nursing station of a ward. The list of medicines required is a department specific, which is prepared by the group of nurses and the group of nurses and the physician, and after the consent from the physician. After consent, request placed forward to the drug therapeutic committee and they will give approval. Only a pharmacy department, after their approval, only a pharmacy department issue the stock to the nursing unit. Now we need to discuss non-charge flow stock system or emergency medicines. These systems include the medication placed in the nursing station that are being used by all patients on the floor. There shall be no direct charge from the patient account. This system will be divided into two main parts. The first one is a drug basket method and second one is a mobile dispenser unit method. Drug basket method, there are some examples like a code blue bag, disaster kit, ambulatory drug, patient bedside medicine. Whereas the mobile dispensary unit mainly include crash card and medication trolleys. So we need to discuss drug basket method. In this method, drug is not directly charged to the patient. This is reserve stock available with the concerned department and the ward. The list of medicines will be prepared by the team of physician and nursing supervisor. The basket method generally includes the code blue bag, disaster kit, ambulatory drug. So the first one is a code blue bag. This bag includes all essential and critical items required during the medical emergency which is occurred in a hospital premises. The medical emergency mainly include cardiopulmonary collapse of the patient, which denoted by the code known as a code blue in the medical terms. Where in case of an emergency, medical facility reached the patient at the quick within several minutes to avoid any hurdle. This bag lifted on the back of each patient, medical staff, and reach to each patient location with the immediate effect. So these are some drug categories which are being included in the code blue bag. I enlisted here for your reference. Next to code blue bag, there is another kit called as a disaster kit. So this is a kit which is used in a somehow larger scale up, which has been related with the medical emergency. This bag includes all essential and critical items required during medical emergencies like disaster, mainly include fire, bomb threat, or any kind of events which has been occurred outside the hospital also. So these are the different events which has been occurred, and for that particular purpose we can use a disaster kit. I quote some of the example for your understanding, like there will be some flood like situation, external disaster like some kind of accident will happen or some building will collapse, there should be a bomb threat, then there should be some hostage like activity, so there will be some emergency like a cardiac arrest, there should be some red emergency like a fire and smoke, brown emergency because of some spillage or something related with the hazardous material. So such kind of activity we can, if some event occurred inside the hospital or outside the hospital, for that purpose we need to prepare a larger kit, and this kit is called as a disaster kit. This kit includes the bulk amount of all essential drugs which is being utilized to manage a large population in hospital or nearby premises where this event occurs, where in case of emergency medical facility reach the patient at the quick to avoid any hurdle, this bag lifted on the vehicle and reach the patient location with the immediate effect. So the third section from non-floor stock system or emergency drug stays is nothing but the ambulatory drugs. Ambulatory drugs are nothing but these are the medication carried out in ambulances to be given to the patient in the need of an emergency case. So there are some drugs which has been available all the time inside the ambulances. Mainly you can find in a cardiac ambulances. This include all essential and critical items required during the medical emergency occurs at the site outside the hospital. You can find here this fellow, they are going to manage the drugs inside the bag, and this bag will always be present inside the ambulance, and such kind of a drugs is called as a ambulatory drugs. The medical emergency mainly include cardiopulmonary collapse of the patient or any severe trauma condition, where in case of emergency medical facility reach the patient at a quick set to avoid any hurdle, and healthcare team members given the first aid to the patient and try to stabilize them for the severe traumatic condition. Examples of the medicines which are included in the ambulatory drugs mainly includes epinephrine, morphine, oxygen setup, normal saline, dextrose, nitroglycerin. So these are some important examples of a drugs which are being included into the ambulatory drugs. So in a previous discussion we will discussed about the non-floor stock system. Now it's a time to discuss about the mobile dispenser unit. When we discussed about the mobile dispenser unit, it mainly include a crash cart. It is a set of a trays or a drawer shelves which is placed on a wheel and used in the hospital for the transportation and the dispensing of a medical emergency medicines or medication or equipment at the site of a medical or surgical emergency. As a life support tool or BLS, basic life support protocol, to potentially save someone's life. The cart carries instrument for the cardiopulmonary resuscitation and other medical supplies, while also functioning as a support litter for the patient. The content of a cash cart vary from hospital to hospital or organization to organization, but typically contain the tool and the drugs needed to treat a patient in or near cardiac arrest. So dear friend, I put here one of the illustration of the crash cart for your better understanding. Here I put a crash cart which is present in one of the hospital setup. So this is in a general, we can say the diagrammatic representation of the crash cart, where you can find all essential, we can say the equipment. The first important equipment is nothing but the defibrillator. So defibrillator will be required and always being present on the crash cart. Crash cart is nothing but it is a simple trolley. Which having a drawers over there, and these trolleys are based on the wheel, and that particular trolley can easily be movable from a single person. So it contain all essential medicines. So in the front you can find a defibrillator. In this plastic box you can find the laryngoscope for the pulmonary resuscitation. Just beside to this one you can find this stainless steel component, like it is highly supplied with the oxygen cylinder, and it includes all essential or life-saving medicines. Which are those? We will see in next diagram. So it having a different drawers over there, round about five important shelves are present. The shelf number one, you can say in my right hand side of a corner, shelf number one always contain the medicines. Shelf number two, they always contain the airways and some important medicines over there. Shelf number 3 is specially dedicated to the pediatric patient, which mainly include the pediatric consumables like ambu bag, endotracheal tube for the patient. Shelf number 4, it contains the adult consumables. Shelf number 5, it contains IV fluid set, ambu bag and the miscellaneous product. So this much of our products will be presented, and all these products are be considered as a life-saving product, and that will be present all the time inside this trolley. And this trolley is called as a crash cart. Cart means trolley, and crash means if any patient is a collapse, for to rescue this patient we use this specialized trolley called as a crash cart trolley. So friends, you can find here different types of activities which have been performed during the crash card. Here you can find the activities related with the nursing, like checking daily defibrillator and oxygen cylinder in each shift, checking daily intactness of a crash card, cleaning of crash card, temperature and humidity monitoring and documentation in each shift. Pharmacist role is nothing but checking expiry date and quality, like quantity of a crash card contained on monthly basis. Then temperature and humidity monitoring on monthly basis, replacement of a near expiratory medicines or consumables as per the requirement. So dear learners, for your better understanding, I put one of the ideal example for a condition where these liters or where this equipment will be used, like either mobile basket, drug basket system or mobile basket system. So that particular incident is nothing but a code blue incident. We need to understand what is a code blue situation. Code blue is generally used to indicate a patient requiring a resuscitation, means support, or in a need of immediate medical attention. The most often as a result of either a patient suffering from respiratory arrest or a cardiac arrest. So in this we can say that a picture, you can see how they are trying to resuscitate this patient. So different members of the healthcare system, they are involved and they have performed this activity, and this activity is called as a cold view activity. The most severe example where we need to perform this code blue situation activity is nothing but if any patient having a pulseless electrical activity, which is known as a PEA, coarse or fine ventricular fibrillation, unstable irregular ventricular tachycardia, frequent. So these are the different conditions where we need to perform this code blue activity. The team members of this code blue activity mainly include the physician, a respiratory therapist, pharmacist and the nurses. So a core team member will be a physician in attendance or any core team which is present over there. This individual is responsible for directing the resuscitation effort. Code blue team must be arrived within the 2 minutes wherever they present inside the hospital and after announcement of this code blue system into their information system. So dear friend, there are some role and responsibility which has been performed during the code blue situation. We will discuss with this physician. Physician is nothing but it is a code blue team leader, which direct the overall patient care, manage the code through medication, defibrillation, intubation, compression or any other procedure required. He is a decision maker. Second one is nothing but a pharmacist. They are responsible to supervise the medication uses and requirement during the code blue. They replenish the use stock within the stipulated time and they will again reseal the cash card. Filling the crash card, seating report and documentation will be done. Nursing, they evaluate the code blue procedure, assist the physician for code blue situation. Documentation, they are responsible for the documentation in a medical record. Then they are also responsible for the medical administration, inform the pharmacy about the use stock in a crash card, indent and replenish the crash card within the 1 hour. Security, they will manage the crowd and situation and support you in the role. So these are the different roles of the staff or the members of the code blue team. So in the third segment, there should be a combination of individual and a floor stock system. This system is followed in the government and also in a private hospital who run on the basis of no profit, no loss. Individual prescription or medication system is followed as a major means. The requirement of the drug or surgical items are given to the patient who purchase and deposit this item in a hospital ward or the rooms under the supervision of a registered nurse. So this is all about a combination of an individual and a floor stock system. Next one is nothing but a unit dose dispensing. Unit dose dispensing, those medication which are ordered, packed and handled, administered and charged in a multiple or single dose unit containing a predetermined amount of a drug, or supply a sufficient one regular doses. A single unit package is one which contain a one complete pharmacological doses form. For example, one tablet, one capsule. So unit dose means if a patient will be prescribed for any kind of a dose, if any admitted patient will be prescribed for any kind of a medication for 3 days. So no need to prescribe this medication a whole strip. You can cut these strips in three important unit doses and send back to this one, to the patient. That particular system is called as a unit dose dispensing system. The advantage is better financial control. It prevents the loss of a partially used medication. It does not require a storage facility at the nursing station. When they require, they ask the pharmacist will send, they will administer. There are the two methods for the dispensing of a unit dose system. The first one is the centralized unit dose drug distribution system, called as a CUDD, and decentralized unit dose dispensing system. Centralized unit dose drug dispensing system or distribution system, all in patient drugs are dispensed in a unit doses, and all drugs are stored in a central area of the pharmacy and dispensed at the time of dose is due to the patient. The drug is retransferred from pharmacy to the indoor patient by a medication card. Decentralized, where a patient profile card containing a full date, disease, diagnosis is prepared. Prescriptions are sent directly to the pharmacist, which are then entered into the patient profile card. The pharmacist takes the medication order. The patient profile card and prescription order is filled by the pharmacy technician, and the nurses administer the drug and make the entry into their record. So this is all about the centralized and decentralized unit dose dispensing system. Now we need to discuss the charging policies of the drug. When we discussed about the charging policy of a drug, we need to understand what kind of a patient is it. Either the patient is ambulatory drug patient, or either the patient is outpatient, or either the patient is an inpatient. So what happened? The doctors write the drug order. That particular drug order reaches to the pharmacy. Then the pharmacy take the record for the all the drugs which is being given to the patient. Then they fill the order. After dispensing the order, they will charge the individual patient. If patient discharge medication will be there, then that particular, after writing a drug order from the patient doctor, this order will be received by the pharmacist. They will fill the prescription. Then after filling the prescription, they call for the pricing, labeling, or the proper selection. Then they will go for the dispensing of the prescription. After dispensing, they will go for either the medication is a free, cash, or credit medication. So this is the next step for the charging policy. Then some medicines need to be credit one, or some charging policies should be a credit basis policies. In that, after writing a drug order by the doctors, the pharmacist will return to the credit. They will issue the credit. After issuing the credit, the final amount will be deducted from their final billing. So this is all about the charging policies of a drug inside the hospital. Similarly, we need to discuss the labeling policy. Labeling policy is very important. The labeling of a medication encompasses the provision and information and the instruction to ensure the safe and effective use of a product by the patient. The safety recommendation and initiative developed by the several organizations are related directly or indirectly to the medication labels which has been used in a hospital. There is one committee called as the Joint Commission International Accreditation. According to that, they will mention a goal called as the International Patient Safety Goals. Based upon these International Patient Safety Goals, there should be a proper use of a patient identification throughout the process of a medication use to avoid any incorrect administration of a medication to the patient. And this body emphasizes the use of a patient identifiers. There should be two patient identifiers. The first one is a patient name, and second one is a UHID number, Unique Hospital Identification Number. In addition, a confusing drug names like a look-alike, sound-alike drug. Some drugs are confusing one. Their names are the same. So for that particular medication, the names are being a major safety concern throughout the healthcare sectors worldwide. So appropriate display of a medication names was evaluated during the survey. So such kind of a labels will be utilized for such kind of a high alert medication, like check well before use. If a medication is a high alert medication, they will give an indication to the nursing staff that always do the double check. High alert medication we will consider like a heparin. So they will put that heparin is a high alert medication. Definitely this medication will lead to the patient harm if they used in the error. So such kind of indication labels need to be stick out on the a product label before they send to the patient department. Like check well, then for external use only, for such kind of liniments or something. Then take with the food or milk, such kind of important will be there. Pregnancy is very important thing. Do not take this drug if you become to be pregnant or planning to be pregnant. Some drugs are contraindicated with alcohol drinking. So such kind of a label should be put into there. System. So this is an labeling policy of a medication inside the hospital. Now we need to discuss about the last part, that is nothing but the dispensing of a controlled drugs. Controlled drugs, again, the drugs which are comes under the NDPS category, narcotic drug and psychotropic substances category, will be considered as a controlled drug. So what is a narcotic? A word narcotics come from a Greek word narcos, means sleeping. These are the sleep inducing drugs. Narcotics are the drugs that induces the sleep. The purpose of narcotic is for the pain management. Like very good example is a morphine, which is nowadays giving to the military persons for the quick pain management. It has been used for post-operative pains, some kind of a cranial abrasion, kidney stone, or we can set up a renal colic pain, then broken bones. So in such kind of a condition, we need to use these narcotics. So the major side effects of the narcotics mainly include drug abuse, drug addiction, they induces the sleep, they produces the hallucination, they develop the tolerance, they show the overall depression effect on the CNS, and also produces the constipation, for example with the morphine. So we need to discuss the commercial forms of the narcotics which are available for the treatment purpose. So when we are talking about the narcotics and the controlled substances, which mainly includes opiates, are medically used to relieve the pain and have a high potential for abuse. The cheap narcotic drugs are nowadays available commercially are morphine and fentanyl. Morphine tablet Vermore 10 mg, injection Vermore 15 mg per ml is available. Fentanyl injection Warfarin 50 mcg per ml, 2 ml ampoule is available. Duralgesic patch is also available in two different strengths, 25 and 50 mcg. All narcotics are the addictive and they have a depressant effect on the central nervous system. So what kind of a narcotic abuse will be there? Users of narcotics can develop a tolerance and physiological or physical dependence on these drugs when they are taken over the time. Tolerance refers to a decreased response to a drug with a longer doses required to achieve the same effect. Psychological dependence refers to a compulsive drug using behavior in which a person uses a drug for personal satisfaction, often in the face of the risk of the health issue. It is the onset of a withdrawal syndrome or the set of symptoms when use of narcotics drug ends, which defines the physical dependence. So this is all about the terms related with the narcotic abuse. So dear friend, now we need to discuss the attempts to control the storage and the dispensing of a narcotic drug. All controlled drugs, including narcotics, are to be stored in a separate double lock cabinet, which is present in a storage area of a pharmacy under the perpetual declining inventory, and dispensed only when the proof of prescription are produced properly. The pharmacy shall maintain the copy of a specimen signature of all doctors in order to have an authentication and recheck. The original prescription of the narcotic shall be checked for the physician name, signature by the licensed pharmacist. All the issues and receipt of a narcotic shall be recorded in a separate book, log book record called as a narcotic record. The narcotic prescription should be obtained in a triplicate form. Two prescriptions should be maintained in a pharmacy and one prescription will be attached to the patient file. Prescription that are incomplete, erased or overwritten shall be considered as invalid for the dispensing purpose. So these are the some attempts we need to adopt for the prevention of any kind of errors related with the narcotic drugs. So dear friend, here you can find the storage facility of the narcotics. As I said earlier, narcotics should be always been stored in a double cabinet where both cabinet or both door having a lock system and two different keys are available with the two different to avoid any kind of a misuse of a narcotics. Then pharmacy shall maintain the copy of a specimen signature of all doctors in order to have an authentication. So whenever they receive the prescription, they will cross check either this prescription is written by the valid person or not. So these are the, we can say that a narcotics drugs like a morphine and a fentanyl nowadays which are been available commercially for the treatment purpose. So dear learners, at last we need to discuss the dispensing cycle for the controlled drugs. When we talk about the dispensing cycle of the controlled drug, it always started from the doctors. So doctors prescribe the narcotic order doctor prescribes the narcotic order mentioned on the drug chart, and duplicate copy means three copy of a prescription will be generated manually in the handwriting of the doctors. Then after that, the nurses do the transcription and indent is raised for the patient against the prescription, which has been reviewed by the pharmacist. Then this pharmacist is responsible for making an entry into their narcotic register. They issue the issued in a patient name by keeping a two copies of a prescription in the pharmacy that I already told you. The stock will be transferred to the area. Then after administration, the monitoring will be done by the nursing staff. After returning, administrating, the residual will be sink off in front of a two witness, and the broken ampoules returned to the pharmacy from the patient area, and disposal of this broken ampoules will be done by pharmacy as per the standard protocol. So after administration, broken ampoules should be returned to the pharmacy. So this is in the dispensing cycle for the controlled drug substances. So thank you all for your patience hearing.